Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Pursuant to Section 5, Chapter 231, Public Laws 1975, this is to state for the record that adequate notice of this meeting has been provided to the public by posting and maintaining the annual notice of regular meetings on the bulletin board of the municipal building, by mailing the annual notice of regular meetings for 2016 to the News Record and Star Ledger in December 2015, and by filing said notice in the office of the Township Clerk.
Ms. Adams?
Here.
Mr. Grodman?
Here.
Mrs. Larrier?
Here.
Mr. Lembrick? Mayor DeLuca?
Here.
Whereas Chapter 231, Public Laws 1975, commonly known as the Open Public Meetings Act, requires all meetings of public bodies be open to the public, and whereas Section 7 provides that the governing body has the discretion to permit, prohibit, or regulate the active participation of the public at any meeting, and whereas the desire of this governing body to comply with the provision of this act, same time to conduct its business in an orderly and expeditious manner, now therefore be resolved by the Township Committee, Township Maplewood, does hereby prohibit, except as set forth in the formal agenda, active participation in the deliberations of the governing body by the public, except as otherwise prescribed by law, does limit the public to the observation of the actions and discussions of the governing body at all of its regular and special meetings.
Second.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the September 20th meeting of the Maplewood Township Committee. This evening, we're going to start off with a proclamation that Deputy Mayor Adams is going to do. After that, we'll have our first public comment period. If you'd like to speak to the Township Committee, please come up to the mic, give us your name and address. Then we have a presentation to the governing body on creating the Maplewood Memorial Conservancy, Memorial Park Conservancy, excuse me. After that, we have a number of ordinances on final passage. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ordinances on final passage. We have a, we're permitting uses in commercial and industrial zone for indoor commercial recreation, breweries, and distilleries. We're going to have an ordinance on refunding a bond. We have an ordinance on a stop sign on the at the intersection of Baker and Maplewood Avenue. We have another stop sign at Field Road and Porter, and another stop sign at the corner of Porter Road and Schaefer Road. Then we have an ordinance that deals with exempting residents age 65 and older from the fee for a flu shot, and we have four new ordinances which we will be introducing. One is a time-limited parking on Tuscan Road between Valley and Prospect. We have another stop sign at the corner of East Cedar and Kendall. And we have a stop sign at the corner of Durand and Maplewood Avenue. And then we have an introduction of a bond ordinance for repair of a boiler flue pipe here in the police building. We have one discussion item, and that's outdoor enclosures in Maplewood Village. Our consent agenda, we have bills and claims. We're going to be awarding a contract for a kitchen at the Woodland, a contract for storm drainage improvements. We'll be appointing an assistant township administrator. We'll be approving minutes, and also making some adjustments to the budget. We'll have our second public comment period. If anyone would like to come up and speak at that time, we'll have administrative reports, reports from elected officials, and then we will adjourn. Before we start, I just want to thank everyone for coming out to celebrate the bronze medal winner, Ibtihaj Muhammad. We had a terrific Saturday on September 10th. We did a motorcade from the New Jersey Fencing Alliance on Burnett Avenue down Springfield Avenue, and it was great to see everyone at the corners and business people coming out to wave. And then we drove through the neighborhood of Prospect and Tuscan Road, and people were out there in front of their homes, again waving and cheering her on. She was in the back of a convertible, as were a few of the Township Committee people in convertibles.
Sweating.
And then we got to the library on Baker, and there were hundreds of people there. And as we walked through the village, it just turned out to be a terrific day. There were over 1,000 people out. And she was a trooper. She signed autographs for a good hour and a half. It was great. I'm sorry, it was an hour signing autographs, and it was really great that she did that. So we want to thank everybody for coming out on that day. So with that, we will start off with the proclamation, and Deputy Mayor Adams will deal with it.
Never done one in this one. Down there?
Down there, yes. Yep.
I'd like to invite the proclaimed Miss Preteen come on up, and your family. Oh, yeah. Somebody will take your camera, I think, Trent. You just got to find somebody. So just while they're coming up, I just want to give a little trivia background. Back in 1982, I moved into a house at 139 Burlington Avenue in Rochester, New York. And my next door neighbors were Russ and Ozzie Edwards, who had one older son and then also had two twin, identical twin teenage boys who lived next door. And that is now Trent, who moved to Maplewood, like, how long ago?
2000.
Yeah, like 15 years ago, just a couple blocks away on Oakview. So it was pretty weird when that happened. But knowing your grandparents, as well as I knew them, being next door neighbors for like 7 years, I just want you to know, because they're both past now, they would be so incredibly proud of you. So that said, I'll try to keep from getting all choked up, but I read this proclamation with honor. Whereas Nyla Edwards, a 13-year-old Maplewood resident and daughter of Trent and Anya Edwards, earned the title of Miss Preteen New Jersey at the 2016 National American Miss Pageant, which was held August 14th in New Brunswick. And whereas Nyla was recognized for her activities that include volleyball, altar serving, Girl Scouts, track and field, acting and babysitting, the pageant was based on her inner beauty, poise, and presentation, which she nailed. And whereas Nyla not only took away an award from this pageant, but she was able to walk away with more self-confidence, new skills, good attitude, and more personal goals for the future that is ahead of her. And whereas Nyla will be attending the National American Miss Pageant in California, we enthusiastically hope she brings the crown back to Maplewood, New Jersey. With this pageant, she will be able to prove that all your dreams do come true if you put your all into it. And whereas Nyla is growing into an independent young lady, as she is working hard to prepare for this pageant, and she will be rewarded for all the hard work and dedication. Now, therefore, I, Nancy Adams, Deputy Mayor of Maplewood, on behalf of Mayor Victor DeLuca and the Maplewood Township Committee, this 20th day of September 2016, congratulate Nyla Edwards on being awarded Miss Preteen New Jersey, and thank her for being a role model to young women in the community and in New Jersey. Congratulations. You should say something. You get in practice. Here you go.
Thank you. I don't know what to say.
You can just say what you're working on for the big pageant.
Well, I'm working. My aunt and my mom are helping me create my dress, and it's like a personal thing going on. I really don't know what to say. I've already written my speech. That's it. So.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, next up we have our first public comment period. Is there anyone who would like to address the Township Committee?
Mike Summerscale, 804 Prospect. I know on the agenda tonight we have the bond for the replacement of the flue for this building. And just given the age of this building being about 8 years old, I think, about this point, I just request that the township potentially look into if there's anyone else that we can hold financially responsible for the failure of the system, whether it's in design or manufacture construction, the useful life on a boiler system and a flue can be anywhere from 20 years for an electric flue to 40 years for a gas oil, high MDH flu. So I just think it shouldn't have failed so soon. And I hate to see the township pay for something if someone else is responsible. And I think for $250,000, it would make sense to do a little investigation on that front. So that's my request tonight. And thank you for considering.
Thank you. Anyone else want to address the Township Committee?
Did you?
No, you can come up.
Good evening. My name is TJ Whitaker, and I'm a resident of Maplewood, New Jersey. I'm here this evening to address an issue that has been marginalized, at least, and at worst, has been intentionally ignored. The incident I speak of is the post-fireworks incident of police harassment and brutality of July 5th. I initially learned about this incident from my daughter. After a fight had been quelled on Valley Street, in which there were no arrests, a friend of hers was walking home with a group down Valley Street, only to be diverted by police barricades and forced to walk up Parker Avenue away from the direction of his home. According to witnesses, this young man, along with an entire group of young people, was herded up Parker Avenue, across Suffolk, and down Midland toward Borden Park, where the young people who attempted to head back towards South Orange, where they actually live, were maced, and some actually had bruises on them derived from some type of physical contact. A week later, on July 12th, Chief Cimino and the Maplewood Police Department were celebrated at a two towns meeting on the issue of community policing, despite the department's actions the previous week. Our community deserves better. The political leadership of this community has been silent around the harassment of young black lives. On behalf of young black and brown children in Maplewood, their families, and decent people of good conscience, we need an independent investigation of the events on July 5th, because as recent events nationwide have proven, the police cannot police themselves. Those of us who have been doing this work for decades understand that it is highly unlikely that your July 5th actions on the part of law enforcement took place without the knowledge and support of department supervisors. An independent investigation would allow all parties involved, the people and the police, to come forward and speak their truth. To do anything less is to sell out black lives and add another layer of fear and distrust between our young people and the police that no cup of coffee can overcome. Despite the official denial of all public records, we will appeal this decision and continue to publicize this issue until those responsible for this violation are held accountable and justice is done. I thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else want to address the Township Committee? Okay. Mr. Whitaker, I just want to say that we have been we have heard of the incident on July 5th. There are certain things that we can and cannot say publicly. So I'm just going to leave it at that. Next up is presentation to the governing body on the Maplewood Memorial Park Conservancy. And there was a document that was shared with the Township Committee on a framework of an agreement. And that agreement was worked out between the advocates who will introduce themselves and Ms. Adams and myself. And we used it as a sort of a model document or a guiding document, the agreement we have with the Duran Hedden Home and Garden Association. So, welcome.
Thank you. You get a good introduction. I'm Gary Nelson. This is Deborah Lyons. We're going to speak briefly, as requested, about the Memorial Park Conservancy. Thank you for the opportunity to do this. I'm going to speak very briefly on a few key points that are covered in the draft agreement that you've been handed, and then Deborah will speak a little bit more about how we got to this point and where we want to go from here.
Get the mic close.
Okay. And I want to begin the discussion focused on two key points. One is the significance of Memorial Park, and then the other is the importance and the benefits that a conservancy can offer. And beginning at the beginning with that comment that all parks in Maplewood, we recognize them all to be important, but Memorial Park is unique in the fact that it has a legacy of design and history unlike any of the other parks. It is a quintessential example of early 20th century planned green space with carefully created mix of active and passive spaces with an emphasis on natural elements and beautiful vistas, all surrounded by structures important to community life. It was originally planned by the renowned design firm of the Olmsted brothers and then followed up by Brinley and Holbrook, all in the picturesque style that was so important the late 19th century, early 20th century. Memorial Park is, figuratively at least, at the center and the heart of the community. It's the largest and arguably the most viewed and most used of all the parks by residents and non-residents alike. It's officially and recognized and landmarked for its significance. It's designated as a local landmark, and it's on the state and national register of historic places. This recognition carries great honors as well as great responsibilities in terms of care, upkeep, improvements to facilities and the grounds. That's where a conservancy could come in. Conservancy is in a position to perpetuate the legacy of the park by establishing a strong and official advocacy component and by providing adjunctive and uniquely focused resources. And this is unlike some of the other key stakeholders in the park, like the township, DPW, Rec Department, even Historic Preservation Commission, all who have many other things on their plate other than one park in town. It also creates fundraising opportunities and capabilities and the ability to initiate outreach efforts. Now, when I talked about the focus that the Conservancy could have, it doesn't mean it operates in a vacuum. It is, in fact, in partnership with the Township and Historic Preservation Commission. That's largely what the document is all about that you've been reviewing. While we have not yet finalized how this organization is going to be structured, it will probably be modeled on other conservancies with some level of executive positions and boards and standing committees, but it'll also have a broad-based membership reflective of the community and the community interests and inclusive of key stakeholders. And finally, it will be financially accountable. So that's a brief summary of some of the key points of the documents you've got. As I said, Deborah's going to kind of take you through how we got here and where we need to go from here. Thank you.
Good evening, Deborah Lyons. I also wanted to introduce here another two of our members, David Dial of the Garden Club and Ginny Kirshen of the Historic Preservation.
We started out as a very small group last year, guided by the master plan recommendation to investigate the possibility of having an organization which could partner with the town to help preserve and enhance Memorial Park and its National Register listing. We spent a year doing a lot of research into other organizations. We visited parks and organizations such as Anderson Park in Montclair, which is also an Olmsted Design Park and is listed on the National Register. We, the Hanson Park in Cranford and Minnewaskan in Westfield, both local parks in the control of townships. And we had the good fortune to have Barbara Bell Coleman from the Branch Brook Alliance come to speak to us. And I'm sure you all know the massive restoration that they've undertaken at that park. That's in partnership with the county and with corporate sponsors. So we found out what's worked, what's not, what their budgets were, what would they do differently, how they organized and operate, what their challenges have been, and what their many achievements have been. And I want to say even a small organization like Minnewaskan Park, they've told us that they've contributed in fundraising and other resources over $1 million during the time they've been in operation for that park. So we've also gathered a lot of samples of bylaws, mission statements, and partnership agreements, and we've drafted some of our own. And also by virtue of becoming an exploratory committee, we've already had good fortune to be able to tap into resources. Our members met with the Central Park Conservancy, and several of us have attended a series of urban park management seminars covering a wide range of subjects that include dealing with donors, establishing systems for memorials, zone and turf management, and a whole bunch of other things. And I think the Central Park Conservancy, you know, really serves as a touchstone for what we can be. The success of their organization is so impressive. You know, if you see before and after photos of that park, or if you're as old as I am and you remember what it used to look like, you know, they have had amazing success. And I know they're big guns, but they emphasize to us that all of their successes and all their strategies are scalable. You can learn from them and use them. And I also want to say, just on a personal note, that it always struck me coming back from those seminars, I get off the train and walk through the park, you know, this beautiful jewel of a park with its vistas and its green spaces and kids playing on the basketball courts and the fields and families by the pond. And, you know, I would think two things. One, we're so lucky to have it, but two, you know, we could make it so much better together. So anyway, after all the research, we approached Mayor DeLuca and Deputy Mayor Adams, and we discussed the idea at a P&E meeting. And I want to thank both of them for bringing this here and for giving us so much of your time working through issues and agreements. So if we do get your blessing, the next step would be to do outreach, public meetings, to engage members and to recruit board and committee members that would reflect, you know, both the diversity and the talent that we have here in Maplewood. We would hope to finalize the working agreement and then start the process of applying for a 501c3, working on bylaws, which we've already investigated the requirements. Establish a preliminary governing structure, as Gary had said, and then kind of kick off, identify some initial projects, and hopefully have a kickoff to raise awareness. So thank you for your consideration.
Why don't you stay there? People might have questions. So does anyone have any questions?
I have.
Ms. Adams.
First, I just want to thank David, Ginny, Gary, and Deborah for all your work on this. I know from personal experience how much it takes to do such things and to start an organization to try to get something positive done. And as maybe in my short tenure here on the Township Committee, it's become known that I've been concerned in trying to find ways to get more trees, for one thing, in town, and also to worried about the condition of Memorial Park after two storms. The microburst in particular took down a huge lilac bush that I used to love walking by. So, but to be able to do that with the context, and that's why the Township Committee and the Open Space Trust Fund dedicated funds for an intern to do the inventory needed for the State Historic Preservation Office to the inventory of trees and plantings and all of that about the park, so that the State Historic Preservation Office could give us their blessings so that we can replenish some of the plantings that have fallen away. But maintaining it, keeping it, especially with the increased number of events that goes on at Memorial Park that didn't used to happen there, the wear and tear that's gone on, the work that needs to be done with the duck pond to sort of make it better, and the river that runs through it, you know. So there's a lot, and it's too much for any department to take on. So I really appreciate your willingness to take this on and to get it started and steer it in the right direction. And I think we share our motivations. So not really a question, because I've been involved a little bit, but just an appreciation and thank you to all of you for that.
Anything? So I think what we need to do is we need to give you a sense as to whether or not we want to do this or not, so that you don't waste your time. Right?
I already have my sense.
Right. You see everyone shaking their heads. This actually, just to put it in perspective, I think it was about 15 months ago when the Historic Preservation Commission came here and gave us a report on the master plan and talked about the conservancies. So we have had conversations in the past, but three of the five of us up here are different people. Mm-hmm. So we need to have that conversation again. I'm prepared to say that we should move forward in establishing a conservancy tonight, but I'm willing to hold off if you all that haven't been in the conversations want to talk about it some more.
Well, I guess having been a little bit in the conversation, I'm absolutely prepared to move forward with this. So.
And I have not been part of the conversation either, but I am absolutely grateful and thankful to all of you for stepping forward to doing this, because I think it's a great thing for the town. I see what the Central Park Conservancy has done in New York, and to think that we have people here in Maplewood who could do that for us here in town, I think is fantastic. Thank you all, and you have my 100% support. Thank you.
So I think what we can tell you tonight is that you have the support of the Township Committee to move forward. On the specifics of the agreement, I think we would want to get the benefit of our attorney to take a look at this. He always helps us get grounded. So we won't move anything on the agreement tonight, but I think there's no major disagreements, but I think you've heard from four out of four that are here, that we want to move forward with this. So I would say that that's a pretty significant signal to you that you want to move forward with your 501c3 designation. And then we'll work on this with our attorney and then get it back to you. We'll go back and forth on that. And then this only would be approved once you got your 501c3 designation anyway. So we have time to do that. But I think we want to give you a clear message tonight that we want to go forward with this.
Do they need a resolution from the Township Committee?
When we have a
to apply for a 501?
No, I don't think they need that, but I think we could do a motion that we're
supporting it.
Supporting that.
Because I think at some point we probably will put it into an ordinance.
Right.
Because it'll be a permanent entity.
Entity.
Okay.
Yeah.
So my sense is that we would, once we move along, we'll put it into an ordinance, but a motion of support, I think, would be appropriate.
Why don't we have a motion that we support the establishment of the Maplewood Memorial Park Conservancy?
So moved.
Second.
Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes.
Thank you.
5 to 7 minutes.
Thank you so much. Really looking forward to getting started.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, we're going to move now on those six or so ordinances on final passage. On each of those, we'll have a public hearing as required by law. So if you have a desire to make a statement on that particular ordinance, that would be the time to come up and do that. So we're on item number 8 on the agenda.
Mr. Mayor, item number 8. Ordinance on final passage, ordinance number 2823-16, an ordinance to amend chapter 271 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood entitled Zoning and Development Regulations. This ordinance will expand the permitted uses within the commercial and industrial zone to permit indoor commercial recreation, breweries, and distilleries.
This ordinance has been published, copies posted on the bulletin board in the municipal building, and copies made available to the general public in accordance with the law. Is there anyone who would like to speak on this ordinance? Seeing no one, we need a motion. So before you get that, you want to read into the record, Mr. Desiderio, the report from the planning board?
Yes, Mayor. Pursuant to statute, this ordinance was forwarded to the planning board for its review. I received a copy of a memo from Adele Lewis, the secretary, dated September 14, 2016. Pursuant to 40 NJSA 40:55D26 of municipal land use law, planning board at their meeting of September 13 discussed the above referenced matter. Upon review, the board determined that the ordinance is consistent with the master plan and passed a motion of support for the adoption of the ordinance.
Ms. Adams, can we get a motion?
Mayor, I move this ordinance be adopted as a whole and the clerk be directed to publish the same as a past ordinance in the Maplewood South Orange News Record according to law.
Second.
Any discussion? I think this is just to let you know, we have a local business that is very interested in expanding his recreation program, so this would be very timely and allow him to stay in the community and I think also use an underutilized portion of our industrial area for a positive use. Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes.
Item 9, Mayor, it's ordinance on final passage, ordinance 2824-16. Refunding bond ordinance of the Township of Maplewood in the County of Essex, New Jersey, providing for the advance refunding or of all or a portion of certain general improvement bonds of the Township, appropriating $6,500,000 therefore, and authorizing the issuance of not to exceed $6,500,000 general improvement refunding bonds of the Township for financing the cost thereof.
This ordinance has been published, copies posted on the bulletin board in the municipal building, and copies made available to the general public in accordance with the law. Is there anyone who would like to speak on this ordinance, which refinances a bond and actually saves the town about $153,000? Seeing no one, can we get a motion? Mrs. Larrier?
Yes, Mayor. I move this ordinance be adopted as a whole and the clerk be directed to publish the same as a past ordinance in the Maplewood South Orange News Record according to law.
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
I just want to state that I'm going to abstain on this because due to a technical difficulty, I haven't been able to review all of the information that's pertinent to it. So I'll be abstaining on this.
Do we need 4 votes for a bond?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
May I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
Mr. Grodman, if you had some time to look at it this evening, would you be more comfortable or you think?
Absolutely. Thank you.
So why don't we table it for now?
Can we get a motion to table?
And then
so moved.
And then my suggestion would be we have an adjournment for a period of time to allow Mr. Grodman to
Thank you, Mr. Desiderio.
Yep.
That's why he makes the big.
We got a motion. Is there a second on tabling?
So moved.
All in favor of tabling?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, we'll revisit it. We have item number 11.
Item 10, Mayor.
I'm sorry, 10.
It's a resolution.
Resolution, which we're going to table until after
that's
number 9.
Thank you.
Okay. Item number 11.
Item number 11, ordinance on final passage, 2825-16, an ordinance to amend Chapter 257 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood, entitled Vehicles and Traffic. This ordinance will authorize the placement of a stop sign on the southeast corner of Maplewood Avenue at its intersection with Baker Street.
This ordinance has been published, copies posted on the bulletin board in the municipal building, and copies made available to the general public in accordance with the law. Is there anyone who would like to speak on this ordinance, which is a stop sign at Baker and Maplewood Avenue?
Well,
seeing no one, will close the...
On Maplewood Avenue at Baker.
Yeah, on Maplewood Avenue at Baker, yes. On Maplewood Avenue at Baker. Seeing no one, will close the hearing. And Ms. Adams, can we get a motion?
I move this ordinance be adopted as a whole and the clerk be directed to publish the same as past ordinance in Maplewood South Orange News Record according to law.
Second.
Any discussion?
We're not really used to stopping in that area. So I'm wondering what's going to be done, or is there anything that can be done sort of to just be able to bring it to people's attention?
We discussed this at the engineering and public works meeting at length. The public works department is not only going to be installing a stop sign, but an advance warning.
Okay.
It would be suggested that there be some warnings given out as opposed to tickets, but that's up to public safety.
And I think we're also going to put the electronic sign there saying stop sign. You know, or traffic change is coming or something like that.
Okay.
Right. Sorry.
Thank you.
Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes. Thank you. We have another ordinance on final.
It's Mayor, item number 12, ordinance on final passage, ordinance number 2826-16, an ordinance to amend Chapter 257 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood, entitled Vehicles and Traffic. This ordinance will authorize the placement of a stop sign on the southwest corner of Field Road at its intersection with Porter Road.
This ordinance has been published, copies posted on the bulletin board of the municipal building, and copies made available to the general public in accordance with the law. Is there anyone who would like to speak on this ordinance? Seeing no one, we'll close the hearing, and can we get a motion, Ms. Adams?
I move this ordinance be adopted as a whole and the clerk be directed to publish the same as a past ordinance in the Maplewood South Orange News Record according to the law.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes. Thank you. Next.
Item 13, Mayor. Ordinance on final passage, ordinance number 2827-16. An ordinance to amend Chapter 257 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood, entitled Vehicles and Traffic. This ordinance will authorize the placement of a stop sign on the southeast corner of Porter Road at its intersection with Schaefer Road.
This ordinance also has been published, copies posted on the bulletin board in the municipal building, and copies made available to the general public in accordance with the law. Is there anyone who would like to speak on this ordinance? Seeing no one, will close the public hearing. Ms. Adams, can we get a motion?
I move this ordinance be adopted as a whole and the clerk be directed to publish the same as a past ordinance in the Maplewood South Orange News Record according to the law.
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you. Item number 14.
It's Mayor, item 14, ordinance on final passage, ordinance number 2828-16. It's an ordinance to amend Chapter 123 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood entitled Fees. This ordinance will exempt Maplewood residents age 65 and over and Maplewood Medicare or Medicaid recipients from the fee of $20 for each flu shot administered.
This ordinance has been published, copies posted on the bulletin board in the municipal building, and copies made available to the general public in accordance with the law. Is there anyone who'd like to speak on this ordinance? Seeing no one, we'll close the public hearing, and can we get a motion, Mrs. Larrier?
Yes, I move this ordinance be adopted as a whole, and the clerk be directed to publish the same as a past ordinance in the Maplewood South Orange News Record according to law.
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you. We have new ordinance.
Item 15, introduction of a new ordinance. Ordinance number 2829-16. It's an ordinance to amend Chapter 257 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood entitled Vehicles and Traffic. This ordinance will implement time-limit parking on Tuscan Road between Valley Street and Prospect Street.
Ms. Adams?
You do that first? Okay.
Sure.
Yeah, introduce. Sorry. I move the passage of this ordinance on first reading, its publication according to law in the Maplewood South Orange News Record, and a hearing to be held on October 4th.
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you.
Item 16, also on introduction. Introduction new ordinance, ordinance number 2830-16. An ordinance to amend Chapter 257 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood entitled Vehicles and Traffic. This ordinance will authorize the placement of a stop sign on the southwest corner of East Cedar Lane at its intersection with Kendall Avenue.
Mayor, I move this. The passage of this ordinance on first reading, its publication according to law in the Maplewood South Orange News Record, and a hearing to be held on October 4th.
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you.
Item 17, also on introduction, new ordinance 2831-16, an ordinance to amend Chapter 257 of the Code of the Township of Maplewood entitled Vehicles and Traffic. This ordinance will authorize the placement of a stop sign on Duran Road at the intersection with Maplewood Ave.
Mayor, I move this the passage of this ordinance on its first reading, its publication according to law in the Maplewood South Orange News Record, and a hearing to be held also on October 4th.
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you. Item 18.
Item 18, introduction of new ordinance, ordinance number 2832-16, bond ordinance providing for the funding of an emergency appropriation to provide for the repairs of boiler flue pipes at the police department headquarters in and by the Township of Maplewood in the County of Essex, New Jersey, appropriating $250,000 therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $237,500 in bonds or notes to the Township to finance part of the cost thereof.
Mayor, I move the passage of this ordinance on first reading, its publication according to law in the Maplewood South Orange News Record, and a hearing to be held on October 4th.
Second.
Any discussion?
Yes. Do have a question. When this came to our attention a little while ago, correct? And did we not? I'm so sorry. And didn't we say we were going to actually look into the liability of the company?
We are.
Yes.
We are, and we have, and we've been doing it for quite some time.
Okay.
Unfortunately, the solution is not as easy as the issue. Mm-hmm. Because of the number of layers of things involved, the issue of overall warranty and the like, but we are not done looking into it. However, the situation requires that it be corrected short term for potential health issues. So that's why we've recommended to the administration that this be replaced, but we're not done looking into the issue.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you. Okay, just for those of you who watch us and wonder why we're doing all these stop signs, We have a new engineer that's been with us for about 6 months now. And in order to do these stop signs, he has to certify them and go out and look at them. And some of these requests have been backlogged for a bit. So now he's working his way through that. And that's why we're doing all these different stop signs. So it also works with some of our initiative of creating more traffic safety and pedestrian safety. So this is an ongoing conversation. You'll probably see more of these ordinances in the future.
And be aware that there are more stop signs out there.
And there are more stop signs, just roughly about 8 that we approved in the last couple of meetings. So. Next up is, let's do the discussion item, the consent agenda. We'll do our second public comment, and then we'll take a break.
Thank you.
And then you can be briefed by Mr. Manning. Okay, next up is the proposal for outdoor enclosures from the Maplewood Village Alliance. And Mrs. Larry, do you want to talk about this from the code committee?
Yes, the Village Alliance brought us a request that outdoor enclosures be available to the restaurants in Maplewood Village during the winter months. We did look into it and we did discuss it with our engineer and, not our engineer, our
construction official,
thank you, Mr. Mendola. And we did come back with, we did have some discussion about it, and what we discovered was that if these enclosures accommodate more than 50 people, 51 people, said restaurant that requests it must add a bathroom. Additionally,
it's if the additional seating in the enclosure brings it to more than 51. So it's the inside and outside.
Oh, that's even more restrictive than I thought.
Right.
Okay, then my misunderstanding. So, yes, then if the entire capacity becomes more than 50, then they must add another bathroom. Additionally, within the enclosure, the regular what did we call it? Passageways between the tables and the chairs and the people have to be the same as indoors. That makes it a little bit of a high bar to hurdle, to jump for some of the restaurants. Additionally, our discussion talked about should they be able to do this, the additional revenue that they're bringing on, and actually they're actually doing this by expanding their premises onto township property. So one of the suggestions that we made was that there be $100 a month fee for outdoor enclosures during the winter months. So and that would just be during the winter months. They did, you did receive, well, I guess Mr. Grodman did not receive one. I'm so sorry. I'll get you one. You can have mine. Oh, okay. We did receive their cold weather enclosure proposals from Ms. Duran, and so we put this to the Township Committee to hear their thoughts on it.
Okay, thank you. And just, the other requirement is that they would have to meet all fire and health department codes, too.
What about ADA passage on the sidewalk?
Well, you're talking about for the patrons or for others? For somebody going by?
Sidewalks, yeah.
Yeah, so they would need they'd have to meet the 4-foot requirement that we have with outdoor cafes. So there has to be a minimum of 4 feet between the end of the cafe and the curb.
And does that include other important things on the sidewalk, like sign poles and?
No, it's the wall. Right now, it's the end of the cafe to the curb.
Right.
We don't count like a garbage can or a pole or anything like that.
Well, I'm only concerned. The reason I think it's more important when there's a wall now instead of just a table that's movable is that if there's no way for people to get by if they're in a wheelchair, for example, and there's a parking sign and the enclosure is literally 4 feet from the curb, but then they have nowhere to go, whereas when there's no enclosure there, people can move the table or the chair over and deal with that.
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask a procedural question? Where does this go, and does it after this to an ordinance gets drafted to allow it, or?
Well, we could do two ways. We could do a resolution which would allow it on a temporary basis, or an ordinance which would make it permanent.
Okay.
I have questions. However, you're going to do it. So what is the? I heard the information about the bathroom and everything. So, restroom. So what is the? That was just information.
Yeah. So the basically what this requires is an enclosure would require, if it gets over more than 51, the code, the building code requires an additional bathroom, or at least you have to have two bathrooms.
Okay.
No, so
if it presently seats 60.
They have to have two bathrooms.
They have to have two bathrooms anyway, so.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that would all be handled by the building.
Right.
In other words, all would have to be is they would have to meet the code, so whatever the code is. So
they have to have an architectural.
Yeah, they have to have an architectural plan also. But if we would agree to this in concept, which we haven't agreed to it yet, then we would have to draft an actual ordinance.
Right.
And then take a look at that.
Yes, we would.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think there's some ordinances out there that we would copy.
Yeah, if I could make a suggestion, if there is a consensus that you want to do this, since we definitely have some time, I'd like an opportunity to look at this and gather some more information, maybe speak to the construction official, and then come back to you with something.
Yeah, well, we don't have that much time because this is a November 1st. This would start November 1st. You know, so I guess the question actually going back to you, Ms. Adams, is I would assume this is a very expensive proposition for a restaurant to do, and probably would want to make sure that they would have an opportunity to use it for multiple years as opposed to 1 year.
Right.
So that goes to more that of speaking for an ordinance as opposed to a resolution.
Yeah, I wouldn't want somebody to invest, nor would I want it to be handled on a resolution, nor do I see a rush to November 1st.
I clearly understand that, and it makes perfect sense to me, except for the fact that it doesn't give the township an opportunity to really review and see whether or not it works.
Yeah, I personally don't want to rush to November 1st.
What if you pass the ordinance and you find that this concept just doesn't work?
Well, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work.
Well, I understand.
But we don't know. I mean, we don't know all the different restaurants that are out there that would be interested in this. So it might work on some locations and not other locations. So this is not a blanket check that you are allowed an outdoor cafe enclosure. You have to meet the meet the guidelines. So those are all the guidelines that are all the requirements that we have in the outdoor cafe ordinance. And so that's the 4-foot passage, and it's the requirement that Mr. Mendola was talking about the square footage per occupant, all that stuff, the fire, the health codes. So those would all have to be met before you got a permit to do this. And so I don't think we have to have everything in here. We just have to say that it has to meet all the requirements. What?
I guess I. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, let Mr.
I just think it's going to be. I don't have a great comfort level that I'm going to have this to you by October 4th.
No, I understand that. I understand that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
As I expressed in our code committee, I'm on the fence with the whole proposal itself. I am not comfortable saying that we're going to do. Turn this on by November 1st, and I don't know what the rush is. I would, and especially now that Mr. Desiderio seems to have a little bit of discomfort with it, I would actually rather at least say, if you want to do a cold weather enclosure, then wait till the really cold weather and do it. Or take this year to work it out and do it for next November. I just feel like this is something, especially if you're asking a restaurant to possibly add a bathroom. I'd be very surprised if a restaurant could get an architectural plan in time to do this for November. So I'm
right, but
I don't see the rush.
Yeah, there's nothing stopping them from putting it up in January if it's something they're going to use year after year. And then also, if the weather provides enough warmth, they can have outdoor tables without an enclosure.
Correct.
As Ms. Lowry said at the beginning, too, I think that the bar is pretty high for the restaurants that do want to pursue this. I think conceptually it's a great idea, but I think logistically it's going to be a pretty difficult thing to do.
But I think we should be realistic. No one is going to put in another bathroom in order to have an outdoor enclosure. Right. It's just not going to happen. Yeah. Not going to do that. So this is only someone who's going to put an outdoor enclosure that falls under that 51 mm-hmm. threshold, because there's no return. And, you know, there's no space in the restaurant to put a second bathroom if that's required. If it already has two bathrooms and meeting the code and can grow, that's another thing.
Yeah, I don't even
there's
think...
There's also the footage, though, and the footage around each occupant.
Right. The seven and the square foot.
Right, and the architectural plan. And I just think November is just too ambitious.
All I was reacting to, and Mr. Desiderio said we have some time.
Oh.
And I was saying that, well, it depends how you count. You know, this is a frame to be from November 1st to March 1st. Yeah. So it only has 6 months to begin with, or 5 months, actually. Well, five or six, I guess, 6 months. May 1st,
right.
It was still 6 months.
But I think they can be as flexible as we want them to be.
I think it's a move. Right. I think we all agree that it's not going to be ready by November 1st.
Right. So what other issues? I think Ms. Adams talking about the ADA passage is a real concern, because you're absolutely right. Now with an outdoor cafe, you can move those around to get people through. Once you have a wall there, as we see in these pictures, that's going to be a lot harder.
Yeah, it's not going to work.
Right.
So it may have to be amended to be 4 feet from anything stuck on the sidewalk. So,
but what about the primary concept? I mean, you said you're on the fence about it. This is, and I think you said it in the beginning, and I think there are others who have said in the past about, do we want to now say on a permanent basis, 12 months a year, that, allow the enclosure, that we're allowing public space to be used for the private business. Now, we do that in an outdoor cafe. So is there really a difference between an outdoor cafe being able to use public space in the warmer months and shoulder months, as opposed to all year round?
I think there is.
I believe there is.
I think there is.
Yeah.
What is the difference?
Well, a little bit of the difference is that and I'm not opposed to it necessarily. I think this could be used in all weather, all the time, and it's out 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, through those months, not like we have now, where the tables, umbrellas, and chairs have to be removed. So that makes a big difference. And it's a permanent structure. It's the same, in my mind, it's not that dissimilar from the enclosures that have been going up, and we've not allowed to stay up all year long for cold weather, coming in or out of a door of a business, mm-hmm. that those have to come down when the weather's better. Because there are some, I mean, if you think about it, these would be, if they're left up year-round, but there's sort of this permanent cloth, sturdy cloth thing on the facades of all these historic buildings doesn't exactly sit entirely well with me.
I also think that in the summer weather, sitting outside, there's a certain amount of summertime, kick back, go out, eat under the stars, whereas during the cold weather, really all these enclosures are to do is to increase the capacity of the restaurant.
Right.
To me, it's a different thing. One is for the patrons, The other is for the profits. That's the way I see it, and that's the difference for me. Or yes, for the profits and the business itself.
Right, which is why we need to also discuss the rent of our property, because I think that's
right. I think that was a starting point.
Yeah.
We just wanted to get it in there. The two things. One is, I think in the these could not stay up year round because they have to be taken down.
Right, but they're up 24 hours a day.
Yes, that's absolutely right. As opposed to the cafe, which are taken in at night. I guess I would disagree with you on the impact, Mrs. Larrier, because I do think, you know, when I've been in places where they have these outdoor cafes, there is still a sense of sidewalk activity because they're open. You get to see people out there. It gives you a feeling that there's some activity going on. So I think it has some benefit to the business district that an outdoor cafe would have. But it is certainly use of public space now on a year-round basis.
And when I look at these enclosures, I don't see any more window space and, well, the one I do see. But Arturo's and this other one, I see no more window space and the impact of watching people that I see at CODA's. And they don't have this enclosure. So I guess that's my thinking.
Right. Well, how do you want to proceed? Doesn't sound like there's overwhelming interest in moving forward here. Do you want to move forward, or do you want to just say not at this time and maybe never?
I don't know. I'm kind of torn. Part of me wants to... I guess I would be willing to move forward with it with more discussion. I don't necessarily want to give township property to an individual business for peanuts when other businesses are stuck with the square footage that they're already renting at a very pretty premium rate in Maplewood Village. I'm assuming does this also pertain to other business districts?
This is just a proposal for the village.
But if we're doing an ordinance, could it not pertain to
it could.
Springfield sure. Avenue or Irvington Avenue?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I understand that it's a proposal from the Village Alliance mostly, but, you know, I don't want to shortchange ourselves. We're basically taking township property away from everybody else in the town and giving it to one individual business or two or three. So, you know, those are some concerns. So if a business is willing to pay, in my view, we certainly could use the revenue.
Any thoughts? I know you were torn.
Or they could look for another location.
I am torn. I'm still torn. I see the benefit of it. I see the benefit to the businesses. And of course, we do want to be business friendly. But I do have a lot of misgivings. I have no problem with further discussion, though.
Okay.
And if moving forward means we have to throw the switch, then I would vote against this now.
Okay.
If moving forward is just continued discussion, I'll do that.
Mr. Grauman?
I think that we should move forward with this and discuss it further. I think that our downtown business district is a very vibrant district, and we want to do everything that we can to allow. It's a destination that people come to for restaurants all of the time. And I think that if we can help our restaurants continue to do increased business during the winter, but also, as Ms. Adams says, to the benefit of the township, you know, with additional funds as well, I think this is something that we do have to explore further. And I would support moving forward with it.
What I would suggest then is that Ms. Adams is our liaison to the Alliance, and that have a conversation with the board about this and some of the points that you've raised and some of the points that others have raised. I think from the code committee, there's really nothing more we can do because Mr. Mendola has given us the information that there are certain tipping points. If you get to over 51, you have to make sure you have a second bathroom, you have to have so much square footage. And he thought that that was, as long as it met that, that he could meet that. The fire chief was there. He had interest there. So I think we ought to leave it. We ought to kick it back to the Alliance. And if the Alliance wants to push it, they can. You can share with them some of the concerns here, Ms. Adams.
Has it ever been discussed in Maplewood to have outdoor dining? I mean, I know it's permitted year-round, but has there ever been a discussion to outdoor heaters? Does our fire department look, are they opposed to those?
They're not opposed to it.
Okay, so that's another option for cold weather as opposed to?
Yeah, I believe Arturo's uses the kerosene ones, yeah, and I think the fire department has, checked them out and they're okay with it.
Yeah, okay.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I would like to, when you take this back to the Alliance,
mm-hmm.
One thing that might actually tip it a little more for me, if this was something that we felt the Springfield Partnership was interested in and they felt might benefit them.
Yeah.
So maybe being that they both have the same.
No, I don't.
You don't think so?
We don't even have outdoor cafes on Springfield Avenue. I mean, it's just
because
it's
just they don't want them. They have never had.
It's just not it's just not part of their business plan.
Okay.
The only one, there's a couple that have. Do we have any cafes
on Springfield Avenue?
Yeah.
No, Mayor.
Yeah, we have a couple of people that put some chairs out there, but at this point, there's not a strong interest on the part of the businesses, the food businesses on Springfield Avenue to do this. There's no reason we can't make it permissive. We could say, you know, we can make this outdoor cafes enclosures everywhere, just like we have an outdoor cafe, which is everywhere. But no one's driving it from the from the partnership, similar to what we have driving. Mr. Desiderio, do you want to say something?
I was just wondering, does the partnership have the information about the bathrooms and all of the requirements?
The Alliance, yes.
The Alliance,
yeah.
They do. Okay.
Yeah. After our meeting, I shared the information with Julie Doran.
I'm just curious, and Ms. Adams will find out, I guess, how many businesses actually have an interest, and given these additional requirements, how many would actually qualify for it? So, okay.
Right.
I think it's going to be difficult.
I'll try to gather some ordinances from other places just to have the benefit of them. They
have other ordinances, I think.
The Alliance.
Okay. So yeah, I don't think we have to do too much. It's their interest; they can find the ordinances.
Understood. Okay.
Okay. So whenever you want to bring it back, we can discuss it.
Okay. And, well, our next meeting is second Wednesday in October.
Okay. Consent agenda, let's just see. We have nothing here that relates to that earlier ordinance, right? No. Can we get a motion on the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on any items? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you. Is there anyone who would like to address the Township Committee?
Good evening, Mayor and Township Committee members. I'm Jeanette Bage Hawkins, and I'm your Essex County liaison, as I was introduced last month. I am just here this evening to bring forth information and to receive anything that you may have that I need to take back to our county exec. I'd like to bring to your attention the leaf pickup schedule. I sent that out to the township administrator and the mayor recently, as well as this evening I brought some booklets on a lot of activities that are going to be happening in the county in October in the winter.
Great.
So is there anything that you'd like for me to carry back to our county exec?
Ms. Adams?
I just want to let you know that you don't have to wait till the second public comment.
I was just getting ready to say that.
I mean, unless you want, I know we're really exciting here, so, but if you want to just go home, you can just do the first public comment. I know it says agenda items only, but we always let Debbie come up.
Okay.
Just to let you know, keep you in the loop, we have been working with Sanjay, the engineer, on some things, so one of the latest thing is we sent him a request to do some crosswalks on Wyoming Avenue, which he committed to doing, but he did get the streets. There's about five streets up there that we would like crosswalks installed, and we also sent him the specifications for those crosswalks. So he is committed to doing that, and just to keep you in the loop in case you're talking with him.
I have one more thing.
See you tomorrow.
Okay, great.
Oh, good. I have one more thing along the lines of the engineer. We have been talking with them about some intersection safety changes on Valley Street, and more specifically, the most immediate thing they can do, and that Asif had said that they would do, would be change the timing on the stoplights at Oakview and at Tuscan Road. Because what... You know, we told them what was happening, that the light's too long when you're trying to cross Valley Street or turn onto Valley Street. So the wait on Tuscan and on Oakview is too long, and that's making people go a little too fast coming down both Tuscan and Oakview to try to make the light when it's green.
Okay.
So if you could get an update on that and have them reach out to our engineer as to what the status of those two things, that'd be great.
Also, in conjunction with that on Tuscan, I got actually two calls about that Tuscan light. Not only is it very long to wait for it, but it doesn't stay green really long enough, so people sort of race through it.
Right. That's what being
that's
addressed.
What we're yeah, we're talking about extending the amount of time that people can come down, not only the cars, but the pedestrians, so there'll be less of a rush. It's become a safety issue.
Okay.
Thank you. Anything else? Thank you very much for
coming
out.
Thanks so much. Remember, first comment.
Okay. Although we do like to keep people to the end of the meetings.
Yeah. But.
Good evening. Frank McGee, 8 Carlton Court. A couple of things. One, I think it's great that we are getting all these stop signs in place. One question I have for residents who are directly impacted, like those on Field and Road, for example, will they be notified that the stop signs are going in before
yes.
they're installed?
Yeah, it was their initiative around speed that prompted the stop sign, so they'll be notified. The other thing we're doing on Porter Road is we're going to be painting a stripe to narrow that street some to give people a sense that it's not as wide open. So, yes, I've been working with one of the residents there.
That's great. I know one of them, his name is Robbie, was saying, because they come down Field and they just
hit
that left on Porter. Great, that's good to know. And then also, because the township's doing great work now on pedestrian safety, is there going to be an awareness campaign by the town to let people know about all the stop signs coming out and all the work on Wyoming? I think it's good work, and getting it out there publicly and transparency would be great. You know, I mean, it's great to see 8 stop signs coming in and the work on Wyoming and as well as the stoplights. So just, suggestions to, kind of raise the awareness, through social channels or even direct mail, need be, just to get that word out there.
We're going to be doing a traffic and pedestrian safety summit the last week in October, hopefully. And we'll be talking about all the things that we've been implementing and the plans going forward. By then, all these stop signs should be in place, so we will have that. Also, the police have initiated, as part of our pedestrian safety, the police have been at the train station handing out little placards about pedestrian safety, how to cross streets, what rights you have versus cars at that. And lastly, we received received a state grant, a federal grant through the state for some pedestrian safety enforcement programs. So we're going to be doing some decoy programs out there. So All that is being put together, and we'll be sort of rolling it out next month.
Great.
And of course, we have the Maple Woody in here who asked me questions about the stop signs all the time. All the
time. That's great.
Little pitch for you. Yes.
And of course, once, you know, we've had, I guess, a grace period, is always very important.
Yes.
To enforce those stop signs.
Yes.
As well. So, and then finally, my last point is, I think it's great news that we're waiving the fee for the flu shot. How will we disseminate that information to our seniors? I know we have a senior share program in town, and they have a Facebook page, but, you know, suggestion is to make sure we get that out, you know, through all the channels as possible, so they're cognizant of it as well.
Well, I know that Mr. Rowe is going to be putting it up on the website. Senior Shares will be getting that information out, actually, we have a flu clinic coming up on
Saturday.
On Saturday.
And next Wednesday.
So I was going to be mentioning that tonight.
Outstanding. Okay. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Anyone else want to address the Township Committee?
Mike Somerskill, 804 Prospect. Just on the Tustin Valley timing, I just want to make sure we're not losing sight of, I thought what we had talked about was making sure that the green light isn't green as you come down Tuscan while the crosswalk
correct.
Is
correct.
Indicated. No. So I checked it today, and it's still the same way.
Oh, no, wait, what?
Yes.
So when you get the green light on Tuscan, it puts cars in conflict with the pedestrians crossing Valley.
Correct.
Who have the walk signal.
If they press the button and they have a walk signal.
Exactly. Right. So I'm just hoping the plan is if you hit walk, you get the walk signal, the lights all stay red.
Right now, that's not the plan, because that's the county. When we discussed it with the county engineer, that they weren't willing to do that yet because of the timing all along the street and because of conflict. There were a lot of issues with it. One of the things long term that they've agreed to do is change the turning on, what do you call it, from Valley Street up Tuscan by, we're looking at ways for them to, and we have to do the diagrams for it, and the same is true on Baker Street, to narrow the street, so to speak, bring that out so the cars can't whip around quite as easy as they can, sort of change the geography of the intersections, but this is the first step in seeing how this impacts the traffic and the pedestrians on there. To be honest, I forget exactly what he said when we were on site, because after we had the meeting with the county on a lot of pedestrian safety issues, our engineer and I went out with the county engineer and discussed a lot of options. So the first thing they're trying is to change that light to lengthen the time that cars and pedestrians can get down and notify, and of course do, as Mr. McGehee said, do a public awareness campaign as far as letting people know that they no longer have to rush, they no longer have to rush to make that left turn. But a big part of it too is the pedestrian awareness, that because they have the person saying they can walk, they still need to be aware and make sure nothing's coming. So there was a reason that I can't on the spot right now articulate for you, I'm afraid, as to why you didn't want a separate pedestrian
time slot.
Yeah, what's it called?
Right. It has to do with the flow of traffic.
Yeah,
and that's one of the things that we have to measure. But we are working towards what you're suggesting, because there has to be a way for people to cross there. One of the problems, as you know, is the button to cross when you're going west.
Some of the physical
is too far back. So we're talking about doing some physical changes there. When I say we're talking about trying to get the county to do that, because it's a county road. So they've been very cooperative so far. So yes, we'd like to do what you're saying at some point.
Okay.
But we have to measure the traffic, because the traffic on Valley, they're concerned that it will start getting backed up and into Baker.
Right.
Or even
the other way. But.
Yeah, but that was the main concern with pedestrian cycle on that light. It would screw that up, and the cars would be backed up to Baker and then up Baker.
Right.
So, yeah.
And the only other question I have is just, I know, and I think it was in July, we talked about the town hall electric sign and replacing that with two mobile signs. And I was just curious if what the latest was with that.
We're going to look at signs when we go down to the, when we see our vendors down in Atlantic City during the convention in November.
So I guess that's right.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thanks.
Okay. Anyone else want to address the Township Committee? Okay. We're going to take a 10-minute break. And I happen to find a signature pad for Judge Varon, so if anybody needs any...
$10.
Anybody needs any get-out-of-jail... Let me know. I can stamp it. We'll be back here in 10 minutes. Joe, do you need the memo that Juan wrote about it? Or?
No, I mean, I'm just going to do it in the thing. Thank you.
You don't
We're
worry.
Just going to go into the...
Yeah.
Every senior in town.
As a mayor, no, I'm glad to promote any.
If you could.
Yeah, we know.
Send it all. Send it all. Library is my favorite.
Because you gotta shake their hands now between now and November.
I can't have it.
But the back of your head, your ass is
not.
I don't know what
I was walking with you the other day.
Sure. Oh, that was quick. Less than 10 minutes.
Yes, that is funny. I'm ready, everybody.
Watch for your face.
All right. Yes. Oh, I forgot about that.
Oh, yeah, no problem. Go ahead.
All right. Roger, did you see my email?
About what?
Or text. About the title work that was being done for St. James Gate.
I didn't see it.
I just sent it to you.
But we have to address that.
Okay. I'm just only saying because you asked me last week. Are we back?
Are we back?
Yep, I'm all set. Thank you.
PBS.
Okay, we're going to, we're back. And let me just find it. Can I get a motion to bring off the table ordinance 20, I'm sorry, where is it?
Number nine
Item
and
9.
10.
Item 9?
Item 9 and 10.
Item 9 and 10, I can't find that. Item 9 and 10.
It's on your agenda.
Right, but I don't know what happened to that. Okay. Item 9.
2824.
Someone want to move to consider that?
So moved. Second.
All in favor of taking it off the table and considering it?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. We have an ordinance on second reading. Did we It was moved already?
It was.
We have to, we tabled it, so we have to go back and do it again, right?
All right, Mayor?
Well, let's read it and let's call for a public hearing.
Item 9, ordinance on final passage, ordinance number 2824-16. Refunding bond ordinance of the Township of Maplewood in the County of Essex, New Jersey, providing for the advance refunding of all or a portion of certain general improvement bonds of the Township, appropriating $6,500,000 therefore, and authorizing the issuance of not to exceed $6,500,000 in general improvement refunding bonds of the Township for financing the costs thereof.
This ordinance has been published, copies posted on the bulletin board in the municipal building, and copies made available to the general public in accordance with the law. Is there anyone who would like to speak on this ordinance? Seeing no one, we'll close the public hearing, and can we get a motion, Mrs. Larrier?
I move this ordinance be adopted again as a whole, and the clerk be directed to publish the same as a past ordinance in the Maplewood South Orange News Record according to law.
Second.
Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you. We have a resolution 184-16.
Mr. Mayor, item number 10, resolution 184-16. Resolution determining the form and other details of not to exceed $6,500,000 in general improvement refunding bonds of the Township of Maplewood in the County of Essex, New Jersey, or such other amount as determined by the Chief Financial Officer to accomplish the refunding of the terms required by the Local Finance Board pursuant to NJAC 530-2.5 and consistent with the refunding provisions of the Internal Revenue Code of 1986 and to provide for the sale and delivery of such bonds to Roosevelt and Cross Incorporated.
Mrs. Larry, are you doing the resolution?
I am. I move the adoption of this resolution.
No. Sure. No? Nope,
I don't.
Right. I'm sorry.
Yes, you do.
I do.
Yeah.
I thought I did.
I second it.
Any discussion on the resolution? Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes, thank you. Okay, we are now at administrative reports. Mr. Manning?
Yes, I have a few items. I just wanted to apologize to the public that the video of the last meeting, for those who watch Comcast, well, Comcast did not work. We recorded on a disc. When we went to make copies of the disc, something happened. So we don't have that disc.
Before or after Caesar left? After Caesar left?
It was after Caesar left. Yes. All right. Thank you. So we're doing our best. So I just want to apologize to them. But next, we're going to have an unveiling of the historic designation plaque. It was 2 years ago on October the 1st that our town hall was put on the national and state historic registers. We have a plaque. It's being installed, and at our next meeting, we'll have a brief ceremony of some sort. We'll ask the historic preservation people, anyone else who wants to come are welcome to, you know, just, it's really something very brief about it, but the plaque is really nice. It makes a good addition to town hall.
I think what we'll do is at some point in the meeting, we'll adjourn, go outside, unveil it,
right,
and then come back in.
Okay.
So it'll probably be in the first half hour or so, maybe after the first public speaking.
Okay, good. The next thing is we've been contacted by New Jersey Transit regarding the mural in the tunnel on the north end of the site there. And so if I'm appealing to anyone in the audience or anyone listening, if they have any information about who developed it, who designed it, etc., the New Jersey Transit would like to contact them and discuss it. So if they could call my office, 973-762-8120, or the general town hall number, extension 2000, I would appreciate it.
Did they check with, like, the news record? I think I remember seeing an article about it.
I don't think...
It was a woman and her kid, and they were doing the mosaics and everything.
Isn't there a name? I think there's a name there.
I saw a few names there, but I'm not quite sure that they were.
And what? Why do they want to contact the person?
Maybe they want to do some repairs in the tunnel, and that mural is there. So, you know, they, I guess they want, don't want to take somebody's art away.
Repair for you.
But they didn't say. So let's just say, I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't,
okay.
Farmers, yes? Farmers Market is open. Again, it's going to continue right through to the end of November, the last Monday in November. Please get over to see it. The great fall vegetables are in, all the root vegetables, everything. It's very colorful over there. And we are Mondays from 2 to 7 at Indiana parking lot at the corner of Indiana and Springfield Avenue. My new assistant starts on Monday. Friday we're having a small or welcoming coffee and meet and greet. So
you're making her come in a day early?
She's just coming in for that. You know.
She's going to become, on her first day, she's going to become in charge?
Well, I'm working all that out. You know, with technology today, you're always right there.
Sure are. We've heard that. That's what the governor says.
That,
That's what he said.
Okay.
He can be anywhere in the country and still be on duty.
Yeah.
That's right, yeah.
On July 28th, we took bids for the demolition of, what is it, Bumper to Bumper. And since then, Bumper to Bumper, the owners apparently have removed it. So I need a motion to reject all bids, and because the project's no longer needed. That would be
right. The owner has removed it.
Project's been abandoned.
Project's been abandoned. Okay. So could I get a motion to do that?
So we need a motion to reject bids because the project's been abandoned.
So
Ms. Adams, seconded by Mrs. Larrier.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Please call the roll.
Ms. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Grodman?
Yes.
Mrs. Larrier?
Yes.
Mayor DeLuca?
Yes.
And yes.
Does that fence have to stay up on the abandoned property? I forget the answer.
We asked them to keep it up.
You asked them to keep it up.
Because we're afraid that it's going to become a parking lot.
Right. Okay. Yeah, that's true. It's easy vacant space.
And dumping ground.
I also wanted to point out we are now recognized by Tree City USA and the Arbor Day Foundation as being a 10-year U.S. Tree City USA. So we
good to see they didn't use any wood.
What? No. No. So we are Tree City, so we do what we have to do to keep that designation up every year. So I think we're pretty proud of this, and we'll put it in our trophy cabinet.
Cool.
That's it, unless there are questions.
So, Mr. Manning, you've received some requests from various churches to use different buildings, and we've had some preliminary conversations, and the question is, do we want to have, right now we've taken the position that we just don't have the facilities to allow for a church to be used all year round on a consistent basis every Sunday or every whatever day they're looking for. So the question is, do you want to have this conversation again, or are we able to live with the position that Mr. Manning wrote out in his last memo?
Which is basically that we have a mission to provide certain things at each of these facilities, and we haven't quite worked it all out. So if we were to give up space for a period of time, that's going to constrain us.
Right. That's it. For example, at the Woodland, our goal right now is to get that elevator in so that we can use the third floor of that building to make it into a nonprofit space and artist space. So with that, there would be potentially more uses of the building when people have are there. For a church to come in and use that or use 106 Burnett, where we were still sorting out the various uses there, it just crowds out any potential use. It's difficult to say no because it may not be used right now, but who knows, in 6 months there may be something there. And if we lock into a relationship with anybody for that period of time, it becomes a problem. It crowds it out.
Plus, it just limits other renters using our spaces if it's to one renter every week of the year for the same day. It just limits the options of other residents and groups, in my view.
I would just say for clarification, it's not necessarily the entity itself, but the length of time. Is that correct? It's really that...
It's a commitment.
The commitment, the long-term commitment that we really can't have at this point.
Right.
Because I think that impedes our, it impedes us being able to pursue our mission.
Right.
So.
Right. I mean, I think there's can also be an argument, or at least a discussion about whether or not we want to use public buildings to rent to religious institutions. That's a whole nother conversation.
For meetings is one thing.
Right, for services.
Services.
I would say that would be another.
Right, that's not this conversation. This is really just a use conversation, that the use of it really makes other opportunities. It's an potentially opportunity lost.
I'd be curious what Mr. Desiderio thinks about that issue that the mayor
I think
raised.
That we should not get into that discussion right now. Because right. We get into lots of difficult issues with right. regard to separation of state and
right.
free exercise.
And
This is on the basis of the long-term use.
Yes, and it's basis on the incompatibility with our mission for these various buildings. So have we settled that for now? Anybody want to put it on for a future agenda item? And Mr. Manning, one last thing.
Yes, sir.
In addition to our Tree City, you remember that Memorial Park was designated as a great public space.
Yes, right.
And they want to do a designation that includes a walkthrough. Do you have any suggestions, or anyone have any suggestions of how we might do that? We could pick a Saturday and just do this.
Yeah, well, it depends. You know, they just want to get together and meet and walk through the park. I mean, is there...
Does it need to be a Saturday?
I mean, I don't know. I think we'd probably want to include people from the Conservancy, maybe the Historic Preservation, others.
But,
I mean, we could do it during the week. It's just on a weekend, it allows more people to be involved.
I think a weekend's a good idea, a Saturday morning or something like that.
Okay.
Do you need help putting that up, or do you want to work?
We'll look at some dates.
Okay.
Afternoon, okay. Saturday afternoon.
Oh, you like afternoons?
Well, I like to get in my exercise class.
Maybe we'll do it. Maybe we could do it the day that we're doing the our talk to the township committee, and then we're doing a cutting a ribbon. So maybe we could do it like a 1:30 or 2 o'clock or something like that. Okay. I will get back to you with that date.
Thank you.
All right. Anything else for Mr. Manning?
Oh, that was the longest Mr. Manning ever talked to.
Yeah. Well, he's alone.
At a meeting.
Yeah, he's alone now, so he has no one to talk to.
Aww.
Mr. Desiderio.
Mayor, I just have one item. As you're aware, there's litigation pending with regard to the issue of affordable housing. The Township of Maplewood has immunity under the former law, and in order to keep that immunity, the Township had to file a lawsuit. Which is, these are being on a statewide basis. I think there's 250 or 300 municipalities involved in the litigation. And it's basically to come up with some solution to the now defunct Committee on Affordable Housing. So, but anyway, it's going forward. There have been a number of decisions in other counties, nothing in Essex County, Middlesex County, and Ocean County. There have been some decisions. And those are now going to be entertained by the Supreme Court. A judge in Essex, Judge Gardner, issued an order on September 16th, basically saying that the prior temporary immunity given to municipalities is extended through January 31st, 2017. He's also ordered some mediation with regard to it. Now, more for Mr. Grodman than anybody else. Depending upon whose numbers the court looks at, we may have excess affordable housing as opposed to a deficit, and that's the subject of this all. This gap period, the so-called gap period, is the big issue, which is still being investigated and discussed. So there's more to come from this, but I just want to let you know that the immunity has been extended through January, and the immunity is from builders remedy lawsuits, okay, where they would be entitled to increased density by virtue of the municipality not having complied with the prior orders of the Committee on Affordable Housing. Maplewood has done that. Maplewood had first-round certification. Maplewood had second-round certification. Maplewood had third-round certification. So the township has complied and continues to have programs with regard to developing affordable housing. So we're in good shape right now. More to be seen by where this all goes. And that's where we're at this point. So but I just wanted to bring you up to date.
But the order says that we also have to engage in mediation.
Yes.
So that has to occur.
Yes. And I'm sure that will occur.
Okay. And it has to be under their supervision, right?
In the courthouse, actually.
Okay, yeah.
It's kind of interesting. Yeah. So.
Because I'd like to see, I've seen some legal notices of other towns that have mediated and settled. But until the,
well,
you know, the,
I, you
the
know,
gap.
We did make overtures to that.
Yes.
And there was no discussion.
Right.
I mean, there was no discussion of the gap period. There was no real engaging in a process. It was, here it is, take it or leave it, et cetera. Subsequently, there was at least one decision that ruled that the gap period, there was no need to fill in for the
right.
gap period. So, you know, it's still so closely unsettled.
But the Supreme Court now has agreed to look at that appellate decision on the gap period.
That is correct.
And so the gap period is a fairly large 15-year period.
Right.
That towns are saying, let's ignore that and just go forward, and Fair Share Housing is saying, well, what about that gap that you guys have been ignoring this for such a long time? You will just want to ignore it again. The difficulty in our case is that gap period is pretty significant.
And we haven't ignored it.
We haven't ignored it.
We have not ignored
no,
it.
No, we've built
it. We've never ignored it.
No, we've built housing and done our rehab component. Right. So we're in better shape, but still the numbers, as you say, the experts, how they arrive at those numbers are,
I mean, the methodology
are just
is it,
very
you know,
different.
At some point, maybe it'll be, but yeah, I mean, I think that it was a direction of the governing body to engage in discussions with the Fair Share Housing people, but there really weren't any discussions.
Right.
It was this is what we'll give you, nothing else, and that's the end of it. And you know, our council didn't think that was right, and our planner. Also
right.
has been very, I think, honest and forthright with us with regard to our position. So I think all in all, we're in good shape, and I think we will comply with the order, and we'll submit to mediation, and we'll mediate in good faith. So we'll see what happens from there.
And I can tell you that I was not well received at the mayor's meeting back in April when I told my colleagues that they need to suck it up and build more affordable housing.
Well, I've told you, I've spoken to some of my colleagues, yep. and their municipalities say, well, that can't happen here.
Yeah.
Okay? You want us to build affordable housing in our town? So, I mean, and therein lies the problem, is, you know, that there are just certain municipalities who just don't feel that they want to have
right.
affordable housing within
right.
their borders. So.
And that's why we like Maplewood best.
And is there anything else for Mr. Desiderio? I have a couple things.
Thank you, Mr.
Desiderio. Uh-oh. You sent the letter, thank you, to Waste Management about the staging. Have you received any response?
I've not gotten a response yet, but what, it's how long
was that?
That was the 12th you sent it,
yeah,
so
it's only about a week, yeah.
I noticed this week they didn't stage.
Oh, okay.
So your letter is very powerful, just so you know.
Okay. I appreciate that.
But I believe also our public works people have talked to them.
Okay.
And actually, I think I did get a letter in my mail tonight from Waste Management. If I can find it before I report, I'll report on it. But the other thing is, we talked at the last meeting about increasing the jitney fees, and I want to give direction to Mr. Desiderio to write this up for introduction. It has been publicly reported. I received no comments about it. Has anybody received any comments about it? So assuming everyone was in favor of it, so we should just inform Mr. Desiderio, instruct Mr. Desiderio to move forward with the increase in the jitney fee from $92 to $100, the combo jitney and parking fee from $232 to $250, and the daily fee from $1 per ride to $2 per ride, and the parking from, I have to find the parking. Parking fee from $2.10 to $2.25. So you have all that, right?
Okay. It'll be on for the next meeting.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Fritson.
Okay, Mayor. The next meeting will be back at Town Hall.
Yay.
Ooh.
Yes.
Yay.
Watch, it'll be 100 degrees.
Ooh. And I think we did pretty well here, except I have no idea what happened to Comcast last week.
Well, I just got a message. There's no sound on Comcast tonight.
Then let's just talk. Right.
Is it still live on YouTube? Or is that
waiting
for the new assistant administrator?
Yeah.
Well,
we're running a disc right now, though.
We're running a disc, so we'll have copies, and then we'll be able to put it up on YouTube as soon as we understand how.
But it was live on YouTube before.
Not last week. It was.
No, no, I mean
no,
just
no,
generally
no. It was streamed.
Oh, we have a whole, yes.
Yeah.
But
so
it isn't
is
right now, no. No, there's another computer involved, and we can't.
There's no
here.
Wi-Fi here for that.
Yeah, here we can't do
okay.
it.
Okay, but we can do it back at Town
back
Hall.
Back at Town Hall we can do it.
Yes.
Okay.
So we
can do it.
Be sending reminders, changing a website that will be going back as of October 4th meeting to Town Hall. Probably at your next Township Committee meeting, we could have a person-to-person ABC transfer should be ready. It's simple. It's I should be getting the information, I think, tomorrow. It's a maple check, just basically father to son.
Right.
And if that would be acceptable to the Township Committee, I'll put that on for the end for the local ABC.
Yes. You're usually tell 9 o'clock or so. We're going to have this little ceremony at the next meeting, so maybe give them an extra 15 minutes, 9:15 or so.
All right. Okay. I usually tell them 9:15, but they come at 7:30 anyway. We've had a lot of filming in town, as you've been aware. We have another one at the end of this week, Nickelodeon commercial at a private residence, and I'll give you the information as soon as I have everything. And
It was much easier to breathe in Memorial Park when they were doing the Flonase commercial.
It was much clearer.
Yeah, I got it better.
Did you get in? Are you in the
commercial? No, I'm not in the commercial. I just drove by and took a whiff.
Volunteer Appreciation Dinner be the fourth Tuesday in October. And that's what I have.
Did you say that? Thanks for having me.
That's all I have.
I said that's what I have. But
oh, okay. I thought you said thanks for having me. I said, thanks for coming. Okay. Anything from Ms. Fritson? We're all set with Clinton School. Have we talked to Clinton School about our plan yet?
You know, I thought about that today about just going ahead and sending a letter to the principal to what our plan is.
Okay. Let's talk. Maybe I can shoot her. Maybe we can go meet with her and talk to her and explain what's going on.
Any news on the population growth or projected growth and new liquor license?
We have not grown enough to get another liquor license.
What is the next threshold? The population number, is that what it is? Like
population 20? Number 7,500 or 3,000.
So we're under 24. We're under 24,000 by a few hundred.
Yes.
So it should be the next.
So 25,000.
The next.
24,000.
But what if we could prove that we have, like, when new people move
we
here
have
and over here?
I don't know if that's permitted.
Oh, okay.
That's what we have to find out. Is there a, when you have development, is there the ability to increase your projections? It was publicly reported in Spotlight that our population has increased to 25,000. But that, I don't know, I mean, that's just a state projection. That's not the federal census. So.
That doesn't seem fair. You have to wait 10 years.
Right.
Between. Well, it's not 10 years.
Well, not anymore, but
if you use the census, it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's
2020, but still, it's like 4 more years.
Yeah. Right?
Maybe we can put
really.
A.
5, really, because it won't be out until 2021.
Okay. So let's keep thinking about how to Okay.
Get more alcohol into town.
That's exactly what we're looking for. All right, with that, report from elected officials. Mrs. Larrier.
Mrs. Larrier, yes. Apropos of nothing, I would like to say that at my building in Newark today, they were filming Elementary.
Oh, they
Whoa.
Were?
Whoa.
Oh,
sorry.
Yeah. That, is that a show?
Yeah. Oh.
Big show.
Did you see?
I did not. I did not.
Sherlock Holmes?
I did not. Sherlock Holmes or Lucy Liu.
Oh,
I didn't see
show?
Either.
I thought,
yes.
I thought there was a show called Sherlock Holmes. I'm so confused.
There is.
There's another one.
There's Sherlock another. And Houdini.
Yes, because there's no new, nothing new under the sun.
Okay.
Yeah. But.
Yes.
One new thing is that if you are a resident over 65, you do not have to pay for your flu shot.
65 and older.
65 and what did I say?
Over 65. 65.
Oh, I'm sorry. 65. So, yes, you 65-year-olds, you can come get your flu shot for free also. And, in fact, you
the
can
mayor
do
can
it
do that.
At Town Hall on Saturday, this Saturday, December 24th from 11 to 1. Yeah.
Yep.
And Wednesday from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m., 12 noon on Wednesday the 28th. And indeed, our flyer does say that it is free for Maplewood residents age 65 and older, and Medicaid recipients as well. Also, regarding Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, open enrollment opens on November 1st and runs through January 31st. And our library, excuse me, will be holding clinics to sign up on November 9th, 30th, December 21st at the main library, and November 14th, November 22nd, and December 6th at the Hilton branch with varying times. 1 to 5 at the main library, and it looks like 10 to 1 or 1 to 5 at the Hilton branch, and we will be putting this up on the website as well. Also, just one thing I would like to remind everyone from our public safety meeting, when you look at the police blotter, we do have thefts in Maplewood, sad to say. Even sadder is that often these thieves are not hindered in their activities because we leave our car doors open and in some cases our homes unlocked. So I would just like to point out that our chief strongly suggests that you always lock your car door and you keep your houses locked. I know we feel like we're in a very nice community. We are in a very nice community. We feel like we know all of our neighbors, but there are people who have bad manners. So I would just like to point that out. And that's my report.
Thank you very much. Mr. Grodman.
Thank you. I have an announcement. We are very fortunate in Maplewood to be represented by an excellent legislative team in Trenton. And today, one of those members of that team, Assemblywoman Myla Jacy, from South Orange, was appointed to be the Deputy Speaker of the General Assembly. And it's very exciting for her. It's very exciting for us. I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew about that. Thank you.
Ms. Adams.
Yes, Mayor. Turned off my mic. Just wanted to alert the public as the leaf blower ban that was in effect this summer until September 1st has been lifted. As people may or may not know, we've had a subcommittee working on pesticide research for lawn chemicals, things like that, and also lawn maintenance equipment, specifically leaf blowers. There are pro, cons, all that kind of information. So we're gathering that. We're also interviewing commercial landscapers, and we will be interviewing code enforcement. But in order to get the public's input as to how they liked, disliked, were neutral, thoughts, any issues they had or any ideas that anyone might have on the ban in the summer and whether or not it's thought that we should continue it annually or even just next year, or any thoughts you have at all. It'll be on the agenda for the second meeting in October, which is October
20th.
And so come and give your input on that.
18th.
Is it the 18th?
18th. Sorry, 18th.
See, they're going to accuse me of saying not to come. October 18th. So come give us your opinions on the leaf blower ban and pesticides and all of those kinds of quality of life issues with relation to that. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you. I have four items. One is this Saturday, I will be designating the day as Our Gang Travel Day. It's the 30th anniversary of the travel agency that's here in town, so it's been here a very long time. And this is, it's kind of strange because you don't hear much about travel agencies, but they do a really good business doing cruises. So, and they've worked here in Maplewood. This is their third location. They were on Burnett Avenue, Springfield Avenue, and now they're in, they share the space with Asta's art gallery. So the 30th anniversary is this year. So I'll be doing that. Last Friday, I was at the kickoff, the grand opening of the Seth Boyden Demonstration School. And we gave $10,000 from our Open Space Trust Fund for trees that are planted there, and they're planted all around. It's really nice. By the way, South Orange gave $5,000 from, I'm sorry, what?
Was it the grand opening of the demonstration school or the
No, outdoor? The Outdoor Learning Center. Yeah. Yeah. What did I say, school?
Yeah, you said
Outdoor Learning Center, sorry.
It's been there a while.
So, yeah, the school's been there a while, and the demonstration school. So they were very appreciative of our support. This was the first time we've used Open Space Trust Fund for a school playground, but we've used it, you know, it was used strategically to plant trees there, and it really becomes a green space for the community. So it was very nice. Wanted to mention that Wawa is looking for employees. So anyone interested in working, if you're looking for a part-time job, Mr. Manning?
Every day,
Tuesday, yeah, you can work there. I think they even provide you a uniform and good benefits.
I could hardly wait.
Yeah, but one of the things we talked to Wawa about was trying to make an effort to employ local residents, so they were very much in favor of that. So if you are interested, you can go on, I think it's wawa.com, and the application there. We should put something on our website, let people know that they can get a job there.
When do they open?
Okay.
November.
I have to go and look at their signs.
November this year.
Yeah. And then lastly, at our Township Sustainability Committee meeting, it was brought up, they were asked to look at our existing ordinance on giving discounts for owners of electric or hybrid vehicles. So we passed, this was in 2008, we passed a discount of 25% on parking fees, jitney fees, and combination fees if you own a car that is an electric car or a hybrid car. In 2008, we limited it to three cars, a Honda Insight, Honda Civic Hybrid, and a Toyota Prius. There now are about 13 cars that meet the 15 hybrid models that meet the 40 mile per hour or greater. So we really need to change our ordinance to per gallon. What did I say?
Per hour.
Per hour, yeah. Per gallon.
Car drives faster than 40.
Yeah, so we need to change our ordinance to bring it up to date. So I'd like to just get that technically correct and up to date. So I will send this to you, and you can move forward with that. And that's all I have. Is there anything else?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, we meet again Tuesday, October 4th at the Maplewood Municipal Building. We're going back home. Thank you very much.
Can I bring my chair?
Thank you.
And for those of you who couldn't hear it,
sorry. Huh?
Yes.